Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Pershore Poisoners by Kerry Toombs. Narrated by Andrew Cullum. Prologue. Pimlico, London, 1870. You know that I am perfectly innocent of this crime. Why must you continue with these infernal questions? The policeman remained silent. I keep telling you I am not responsible for the death of my poor wife. Why don't you believe me? Pleaded the young man, looking across the table at the uniformed officer.
If you would just answer some more of her questions, Captain Quinton, we would be obliged.
Confound you, Inspector, sighed the man, leaning back in the chair and staring up at the grey ceiling of the small, uninviting room.
How long were you and your wife married, sir?
Asked the policeman, mopping his sweating brow with a large brown handkerchief and coughing as he did so. I've told you 3 times already. My wife and I had only been married for 3 months.
Make a note of the good captain's answers, Constable,
instructed the questioner, addressing the young man standing by the door.
We may need to produce them in evidence.
Yes, sir.
Now then, when did you and your wife move to Pimlico?
Shortly after we were married.
When did your wife first become unwell?
About 3 weeks ago. She complained of severe pains in her stomach. She was also violently sick in the night.
And what did you do, sir?
Asked the inspector, leaning forwards and coughing noisily into his handkerchief. I called for Dr. Cranford. He came and attended my wife. His conclusion was that she must have eaten something which had disagreed with her.
And what happened next, sir?
Well, he prescribed some medicine for my wife, Charlotte, and advised her to remain in bed for a few days until she recovered.
And did your wife make a recovery, sir?
She appeared to rally after 2 or 3 days, but then the illness returned with the same symptoms. I again called for Dr. Cranford. He treated her and said that we were to feed her on a light gruel until she recovered.
But your wife did not recover, did she, sir?
Said the policeman, before sneezing twice into the handkerchief. No. She seemed to fall into a decline. She was unable to keep down any food for more than a few minutes. I was desperate, Inspector Roberts, and I could not understand it. Believe me when I tell you that I would have done anything to save her, replied Quinton earnestly.
Can you tell me what happened yesterday, sir? If you please,
asked Robertson before repeating the sneeze. Good heavens, man, can't you take something for that cold?
It's not a cold, sir, it's a condition I have. There is no cure. Now, if you will kindly answer the question, sir, I should be obliged.
It was shortly before 3 o'clock in the morning. Rachel, the maid, woke me and told me that her mistress was in great pain. I hastily dressed and went into her room. It was dreadful. My wife was screaming out in agony, clutching her stomach and crying out that she was dying. I had never seen her look so deathly white.
Very distressing, no doubt, sniffed Robertson.
We did all that we could to comfort her. I held her in my arms as she passed away, replied the young man, burying his face in his hands.
I'm sorry. I cannot go on. This is all so upsetting. Can I have some water?
Constable, give the captain a glass of water,
instructed Robertson, sneezing into his handkerchief once more. The young policeman poured out the water from a flagon and handed it to the distressed man. Robertson leaned back in his chair and studied the man as he swallowed the liquid.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Is there anything else I can help you with?
What do you think was the cause of your wife's illness, Captain Quinton?
I don't know. I only wish I did. Then I could have saved her. It could have been something she inherited from her family, I suppose, or a reaction to something she had eaten,
replied Quinton, recovering his composure.
You say that you and your wife had only been married for 3 months. Where did you first meet your wife, sir? At Pershore in Worcestershire. We were staying at the same hotel.
What were you doing there, sir?
I was spending a few days there on holiday. Why do you ask these questions? It is of no concern of yours as to how my wife and I met. All this is becoming irritating, Inspector. I think I have answered enough of your questions. Now, if you will excuse me, I must attend to the arrangements for my wife's funeral, said Quinton, rising from his chair.
Just one moment, sir. Constable, if you please,
said the detective, sneezing once more before addressing his younger colleague. The policeman reached into his pocket and handed his superior a small book.
What is that? Inquired Quinton.
A diary, sir. Written by your late wife.
What? I don't understand, said Quinton, looking down uneasily at the item on the table. Where did you get that?
We found the diary concealed between a number of items in the drawer of your wife's bedside cabinet. Were you aware, sir, that your wife kept a diary?
No, of course not. You made a search of my wife's effects.
This is intolerable, sir. You have no right to be prying into my wife's affairs. Good God, man! Have you no feelings or compassion at all? My wife has just died,
shouted Quinton whilst reaching out for the book.
Just one moment, sir,
said Robertson, taking hold of the work before banging it down on the desk.
We have every right, sir. A young innocent lady, struck down in the very prime of her life for no apparent reason. Dead in the middle of the night. I would say that that more than encourages us in our investigations, sir. Constable, perhaps you would care to read aloud from the deceased's diary. I am sure that Captain Quinton will find the entries most enlightening.
This is not to be borne, Inspector. I will report this gross violation of privacy to your superior. Now I suggest you give me that diary at once, man, demanded Quinton, rising from his seat.
Constable, if you would,
instructed Robertson.
From where, sir? Inquired the young policeman.
From the young lady's arrival in Pershore. Do take a seat, Captain. I am sure that if you are innocent in your wife's death, as you say you are, then you will have nothing to fear from your wife's words.
Damn you, man!
Snapped Quinton, glaring at the detective before resuming his seat. The constable began reading aloud from the diary.
7th of July. Arrived in Pershore this afternoon by the early coach from Oxford. Quite why I have come to this place I cannot really comprehend. The coach stopped to change horses at the Angel, and as I had little inclination or desire to continue the journey to Worcester, I inquired whether they had rooms to let, and have taken one at the front of the building for a few days. Since the death of my poor, beloved Albert, it is as if my life has come to an end. Hardly a day goes by when I do not think of how our lives would have been so complete together, but it was not to be. Oh, why did Albert have to go to India? To die in an unknown foreign land and to leave me so bereft is cruel. Now I am alone, and know not what I am to do with the remainder of my poor life.
8th of July. Did not really want to leave my hotel room this morning, and had no desire to venture out and explore the town. They say Pershore is a pretty place, with some fine buildings and an abbey of some importance, but although I can see signs of life in the town square from my bedroom window, it fails to attract me. Just lay on the bed all day thinking of my dear Albert, and what our lives might have been.
9th of July. My chambermaid, a young, whimsical kind of girl, could not understand why I had no desire to venture out to explore the town. I explained to her that I had not been well, and that all I desired was complete rest and to be left alone with my thoughts. I do wish that these people would not seek to impose their desires upon one. The 10th of July. Have visited the ancient abbey at last. I was not sure that I wanted to leave the sanctuary of my room. I'm content with my own company and require no other, but the maid spoke of it again and gave me an odd look. so I gave in rather than have people think I am strange or mad. And what a fine building it is! I stood outside for some minutes, not knowing whether I should venture inside. The choir boys were singing evensong when I entered, and for a moment as I stood there it seemed that everything in my past life had slipped away. And then a strange thing happened. As I turned to leave, I accidentally dropped my umbrella on the floor, and before I could bend down to recover it, I found that another had retrieved it for me. A tall, thin gentleman, dressed entirely in black, smiled briefly as he bowed and handed the umbrella back to me. I thanked him, and was about to move away when he inquired whether we had met before. I told him that we had not. Then he said he thought he had seen me the other night in the dining room of my hotel, and yes, it appears that he is a guest at the same establishment. He then apologized for his intrusion and quickly made his way out of the building. What a peculiar thing to have happened. The 11th of July. After writing those words yesterday, I had quite expected to see the mysterious stranger at dinner that evening, but it was not to be. And then this morning, as I walked along the main street of the town, whom should I see coming towards me but the same gentleman I had encountered in the abbey yesterday afternoon? We exchanged a few words of recognition. I asked if he was still resident at the hotel, as I had not seen him at dinner the previous evening, to which he replied that he had been called away on urgent business, which had prevented him from dining there. And then he asked me if I would care to dine with him that evening, seeing as we were both staying at the same hotel. I considered this suggestion rather improper, especially as we had only met once before, and anyway I had no desire to converse with anyone at the present, and so I declined his invitation. The 12th of July. Encountered my stranger again this morning, who was standing outside the hotel when I walked out. Most apologetic for his behaviour yesterday. Had not wished to cause any offence. I told him that none had been taken. Then he asked if I might assist him in a task which he was about to undertake. It seems that an aunt of his had written to him that very day asking him to purchase some lace handkerchiefs for her, and that he was quite at a loss as to what he should choose, and that if I could possibly advise him in any way regarding this purchase, he would be eternally in my debt. I was so taken aback by this unexpected demand that my first inclination was to refuse and quickly make my way back inside the hotel, but he looked so sad and seemed so much at a loss that I could not refuse, and so it was that we visited one or two of the local shops in an attempt to complete his errand. I must say that I have never been asked by a stranger before to assist him in such a manner. 30 minutes later the deed had been done. My stranger introduced himself as a Captain Quinton. He thanked me most profusely for my assistance and helpful advice, and then we went our own separate ways. What an unusual thing to have happened. The 13th of July. No sign of Captain Quinton today. I'm somewhat relieved. The 14th of July. I was on my way into dinner tonight when whom should I encounter but Captain Quinton. He said that he had sent the lace handkerchiefs to his aunt, who had just written to say how pleased she was with them. He was most grateful for my guidance, and said that he would be extremely grateful, and how could he possibly repay me for such kindness. I told him that I had been pleased to be of assistance to him, and that there was no need for him to repay me. However, he was most insistent that he would like to be of service to me. He said that he intended visiting the nearby town of Ledbury the next day, and that if I would care to accompany him on this excursion, I would be most welcome. Well, I was taken aback by this proposal, but he looked so sad that it seemed churlish to refuse. Now that I have written these words, I'm beginning to regret my hasty decision. Perhaps I will send a message in the morning to say I am unwell. The 15th of July. Well, in the event, I did not send that message, and have just returned from a wonderful day's excursion to Ledbury. Captain Quinton had hired a chaise, no less, complete with groom. The weather was fine, warm sunshine with a gentle breeze, but not unpleasantly hot. Ledbury is a fine town indeed, with some old buildings and an interesting ancient marketplace. We walked up a narrow cobbled street to view the church, where a local guide showed us around the building, pointing out all the interesting features. Then Captain Quinton said that we should partake of some refreshments at one of the local inns. Although it was such a pleasant occasion, poor Captain Quinton came over suddenly quite sad, and at one point I almost thought that he was going to cry. I must say that I felt very uneasy, and wished that I had not been so bold as to have undertaken such an excursion with a gentleman who was so unknown to me. Then the captain apologized for his unhappy state. It appears that poor Captain Quinton's wife died of smallpox the previous year, and that he has been left quite alone in the world. This day had been the first day in which he had obtained some relief from his unhappy state. He hoped I would understand. I explained to him that I, too, had recently lost someone who had been close to me. It seems that we had both come to Pershore to seek some relief from the situations in which we had found ourselves. We are like two little orphans who have lost our way. Poor Captain Quinton. As we drove back to Pershore, he said very little, and I must say that I was quite relieved when we returned to the hotel. July the 16th. I lay in bed last night going over the events of the day, and it must have been 3 in the morning before I finally went to sleep. Upon coming downstairs this morning, the first person I met in the hallway was Captain Quinton, who appeared to be in quite an agitated condition. He was most insistent that we breakfast together, and once we had been seated, he apologized earnestly for his behavior yesterday. He had not wanted to burden me with the news of his wife's death. I told him that I quite understood, and that I had not been offended in any way by his conduct. With this, he seemed quite satisfied. Then he suggested that there was a performance of the Messiah that evening in the Abbey, and he would be honored if I would accompany him. Have just returned from the Abbey. What a wonderful evening. The Messiah has always been one of my favourite choral works, and all the performers gave a spirited rendition. Then, whilst we were taking some refreshment in the interval, Captain Quinton told me of his former military career, and it seems that both the captain and my beloved Albert were both members of the same regiment in India. What an amazing coincidence! I was quite taken aback. And the more that Captain Quinton talked of his army days, the more it seemed that he was bringing me ever closer to Albert. The 17th of July. Captain Quinton, or Charles, as he now insists on my addressing him, took me to see the scenery at Simmons Yat today. What a beautiful landscape! As I looked down into the valley at the meandering river, I believed that today was the first day this year that I had been truly happy. Afterwards we partook of some refreshment in Ross-on-Wye, a most agreeable town. The journey back to Pershore was quite charming. Charles is becoming a most pleasant companion, and it seems that my presence has also brought some respite from his suffering. The 22nd of July. Almost 5 days since my last entry. I have been so occupied accompanying dear Charles on a number of excursions to Worcester and Malvern and dining out each evening that I have not had time to take up my pen. I could not believe that life could be so pleasant once more. At Malvern we hired some donkeys at St. Anne's Well, which took us up the steep, winding paths to the very top of the beacon, from where we looked down on all the countryside for miles around. I must say that I am growing quite fond of Charles and enjoy his company more and more. He is quite handsome in appearance, and is always immaculately dressed and never without a flower in the buttonhole of his coat. The 24th of July. I am in a complete state of uncertainty and disarray. This evening over dinner, Charles announced that he had to return to London the following afternoon. Apparently he has a number of business affairs there that require his most urgent attention, and he does not believe that he will return to Pershore for quite a long time. I became very sad on hearing this news. Then quite suddenly he grasped my hand and proposed to me. I was absolutely taken aback. He said that after his wife had died, he had come to believe that he would never find true happiness again, but that during these past days I had brought such joy into his life that he could not bear it if we were to go our separate ways. Seeing that I was startled by his announcement, he apologized if he had been forward in expressing his feelings, and he quite understood if I would like some time to consider his proposal and give him my answer tomorrow. Oh dear, what am I to do? I have enjoyed Charles's company so much over these days, and the thought of his leaving the day after next and my never seeing him again is too much to bear. I believe we could make each other so happy. We are both alone in this world, but what am I to do? To accept his offer would be a kind of betrayal of the love I once had for dear Albert. No, I must decline his offer, and that will be an end to it. The 25th of July. Captain Quinton and I are engaged to be married. I had quite made up my mind to refuse him this morning, but when I saw him striding up and down the hall and looking so anxious and forlorn, my heart went out to him, and I knew then that if we were to go our separate ways, we would be denying ourselves true happiness. Charles then held me quite close, and said that this day would be the first of many days filled with such warmth and light. As he has to leave later today, he asked whether I would accompany him to London, where we may be married as soon as possible. How can I explain my joy? The 8th of August. I cannot believe that 2 weeks have gone by since my last entry, but my life has been so eventful and filled with such love and happiness that to put pen to paper would have seemed an intrusion. I am now Mrs. Quinton. Charles and I were married at a little church in Pimlico, where we have secured rooms in one of the most delightful Georgian houses in one of the squares, overlooking a small pleasant garden. I have been quite busy buying things for our home and seeing that everything is just right for when Charles returns from the city every evening. Charles has engaged a maid to see to our every need. She is called Rachel. I shall be quite spoiled. I have never been so happy. I believe we are quite content. The 10th of August. Awoke yesterday evening with a terrible pain inside my stomach, and being violently sick. Charles was most attentive and called for the doctor. It seems I have eaten something which has proved disagreeable to me. Dr. Cranford has prescribed some medicines for me and instructs me only to eat a little gruel until I am better. Was feeling much better this afternoon to write these words. The 11th of August. Feeling much improved today. Charles says I must stay in bed for a day or so until I am completely well. The dear man. He is such a comfort to me. The 15th of August. Today was the first day that I have ventured out since my illness. We walked down to the river and sat in the little park there, enjoying the warm sunshine and admiring the views. The 18th of August. I asked Charles this morning why we have not entertained. Surely there must be some friends of his he would care to invite for dinner one evening. Charles replied that all his friends were away at present in the country, but that he would invite them next month upon their return. It is certainly strange that no one ever calls upon us. The 25th of August. Have not been able to write for several days due to the return of my illness. Suffered acute pains and was violently sick again. Charles said he would move into the spare bedroom so that I might obtain as much rest as possible. My darling is most attentive. Upon his return from the city in the evenings, he insists on making some soup or gruel and bringing it up to the bedroom, and then reads to me whilst I consume the liquid. I must confess, however, that I have little appetite. The 1st of September. What is wrong with me? I can hardly write these words. I am so weak. The medicine I take seems to do little good. I cannot eat any food, and when I manage to drink some soup, I am only sick again. I have not been out of the house for nearly 2 weeks now. What is wrong with me? I am becoming such a burden to Charles. Would he have married me if he had known that I would have become so ill? The 4th of September. No better. I feel so ill. Why is it that I am so ill? Why has God deprived me of my happiness?
The 5th of September.
I feel the end is coming. Why does Charles insist that I drink the soup when I am so unwell?
The 7th of September.
God help me, Charles has poisoned me. There is no escape.
That is the last entry, sir, said the constable, closing the diary.
Oh, my God!
Exclaimed Quinton, burying his face in his hands.
I believe your wife brought a sizable inheritance to your marriage, sir, if I am not mistaken,
said Robertson, leaning forwards and staring directly at his suspect.
That is no concern of yours. I tell you I am innocent, pleaded Quinton, looking at the two policemen. Why don't you believe me?
That's as may be, sir. Constable, will you read the last entry again, if you please?
Yes, sir. God help me, Charles has poisoned me. There is no escape, replied the constable. The hand is very shaky, sir.
God help me, Charles has poisoned me. There is no escape,
repeated Robertson.
Well, Captain Quinton, I think that is all the proof we need. I would say that any jury in the land would convict you on that evidence. You will certainly hang, Captain Quinton, and very slowly, if there is any justice in this world. Yes, you will hang very well indeed. Would you not agree, Constable?
It would seem so, sir.
Take the prisoner away, and, oh, Ravenscroft, see that this is all kept quiet for the time being.
Yes, sir.
Chapter 1. Ledbury, September 1890. What is this, my dear? Asked Ravenscroft, looking over his spectacles at the bowl of thick, dark liquid which lay before him on the dinner table. Brown Windsor soup, replied Lucy.
I see.
You don't like it? No, it's just that...
I can tell that you don't approve.
No, it's just that it is rather on the thick side,
said Ravenscroft, submerging his spoon once again into the brown mixture. I think it's quite nice, smiled Lucy, after taking another mouthful.
I expect that I shall probably grow to like it.
I think Susan has done rather well. I believe that it is a favourite of Queen Victoria.
Ah, well, if it is good enough for Queen Victoria, then I am sure that it is certainly good enough for us, smiled Ravenscroft, before bringing the spoon to his mouth.
There is no need for frivolity, Samuel. I can tell you do not like it. It does have some of the Madeira in it, said Lucy, trying to sound enthusiastic. No, it's not the Madeira. It's just... Well, just before we sat down, I was reading the evening newspaper. It seems that a whole party of guests staying at one of the lodging houses in Pershore fell ill after eating a meal of brown Windsor soup, pheasant pie and cheese.
Could it have been the pheasant pie? Suggested Lucy.
Perhaps, but then it could have easily been the brown Windsor soup. I suppose the dense brown viscosity of the dish could hide anything of a suspicious nature.
I saw Susan prepare it. Beef, lamb, vegetables, faggots of herbs.
Certainly a great deal of things.
Did any of these people die as a result of this meal? Asked Lucy, becoming irritated by her husband's questioning.
Yes, apparently one of the guests died during the night after eating the soup.
Well, don't eat it if you don't want to. I'll ring for Susan to take it away, said Lucy, thrusting her spoon back into the bowl with a clatter.
No, don't do that. I'm sorry. I'm sure it is all right, replied Ravenscroft, taking another sip of the liquid. Actually, it is quite pleasant.
I do wish you would make up your mind, Samuel.
I have. The soup is fine.
You are only saying that so as not to hurt my feelings.
No, not at all. It really is very good.
Now I come to think of it, it does have a rather peculiar odour, said Lucy after taking another mouthful. I think we should leave it. Perhaps the lamb was not as fresh as it should have been. I will have a word with the butcher.
If you say so, but don't reject the dish on my account.
No. I don't like it. We should definitely leave it, said Lucy, ringing the small handbell on the table.
Now you are annoyed with me, said Ravenscroft. I am sorry, I should not have mentioned it.
Susan, I think we have had enough of the brown Windsor. If you would take it away, please, said Lucy, ignoring her husband's last remark and addressing the maid as she entered the room. Yes, ma'am, replied the maid, casting a suspicious eye at the half-full bowls.
Suddenly the loud noise of the front doorbell being pressed broke the silence of the room.
Surely that cannot be Tom Crabb again. It seems that every time we sit down to eat, our meal is interrupted by some police matter or other, said an annoyed Lucy.
Shall I tell him to wait, Mrs. Ravenscroft, until after I have served the main course? Asked Susan.
No, I suppose you had better let him in, replied a resigned Lucy.
I'm sorry, my dear. I'm sure it must be something of great importance for Tom to call upon us at such a late hour, suggested Ravenscroft, hoping to placate his wife. The maid left the room and returned a moment or two later.
Please, Mr. Ravenscroft, it's not Constable Crabb, it's a young lad. Says he must speak to you most urgently.
Strange. Did this youth give his name? Asked Ravenscroft.
No, sir, replied the maid. Then I think you should instruct him to visit the police station. Tell him we are dining and cannot be disturbed, instructed Lucy.
Sorry to intrude, Mr. Ravenscroft, said a young man, peering round the doorpost.
Stebbins! Exclaimed Ravenscroft.
Sorry for the interruption, Mr. Ravenscroft, Mrs. Ravenscroft,
said the smiling, fresh-faced youth, removing his cap and stepping into the room.
I knows you was dining, sir, but I thought you would want to know as soon as possible.
Who is this young man? Asked a bewildered Lucy.
This is Stebbins, the boots whom I first encountered at the Tudor when I first visited Malvern, explained Ravenscroft. What is it, Stebbins? You can see that we are busy at the moment.
Terrible business, sir. Poisoned he was, pronounced the youth with a flourish.
Who has been poisoned? Asked Ravenscroft, regretting that he had asked the question even before he had uttered the words.
Him that ate the brown Windsor, only he didn't. Him at Pershore, Maisie said he didn't eat it.
Stebbins, you're not making any sense. Wait in the kitchen until after we have finished our meal. Have you eaten?
No, sir. Came as soon as I heard the news.
Then, Susan, you had better give him some food, instructed Ravenscroft. May I suggest some of the brown Windsor?
Oh, thank you, Mr. Ravenscroft. Don't like the look of that soup, though, if you don't mind my saying so,
replied Stebbins, casting a glance at the half-empty bowls and turning up his nose.
Looks a bit murky to me. Here, young man, you mind what you're saying, reprimanded the maid.
Take him to the kitchen, Susan, repeated Ravenscroft. The lad followed the maid out of the room.
What a strange-looking young man, said Lucy after the door had been closed.
He has a rather vivid imagination, I'm afraid. Still, he was helpful to us at Tewkesbury earlier this year.
How old is he?
Oh, about 13 or 14, I believe.
And you say you first met him at the Tudor in Malvern? Asked Lucy.
Yes, he looked after me there. He was quite useful in providing me with food late at night, when the so-called cure prevented any indulgences.
Sounds as though you had better see what he wants after dinner.
Now then, Stebbins, what is all this about? Asked Ravenscroft, striding into the kitchen some minutes later.
It's that gent in Pershore, him that drank the soup, only he didn't, if you see what I means,
said Stebbins, looking up from the table, his mouth full of bread and cheese. I take it you are referring to the party who suffered ill effects from consuming the brown Windsor soup.
Yes, sir. They all had the soup and were ill, but the gent didn't, and he was the one that died,
announced Stebbins. I think you'd better start at the beginning, said Ravenscroft, sighing as he sat down on one of the chairs. I did not know that you were living in Pershore. I thought you were still employed at the Hop Pole in Tewkesbury.
So I am, sir.
Then how do you know what is going on in Pershore?
Ah, well, Mr. Ravenscroft, it's all on account of Maisie. She knows, replied the youth, tapping the side of his nose before cutting himself another large chunk of cheese and cramming it into his mouth.
And who is this Maisie? Asked Ravenscroft, wondering where all this line of inquiry was going.
Maisie is my girl. She works at Talbots Lodging House. Scullery maid, she is. She saw everything.
Go on.
Well, Maisie says that all the guests sat down that night to eat the brown Windsor, and that they was all bad afterwards, some of them worse than others. Only the gent that died, he didn't have any of the soup, but he was dead in his bed the next morning. Dead as a cold cucumber he was, all stiff and white he were, been frothing at the mouth, his face all twisted in agony,
said Stebbins, warming to his subject.
Yes, yes. Spare us the graphic detail, Stebbins.
Oh, well, he were dead, as I said, Mr. Ravenscroft. Dead.
And you say that the guest who died did not partake of the soup? Was the scullery maid sure on this point? Inquired Ravenscroft, becoming more interested in the lad's account.
My Maisie, she's a sharp one. She don't miss anything. If she says that gent didn't eat the brown Windsor, then he didn't,
said Stebbins, springing to the maid's defence. It could have been the pheasant pie, suggested Ravenscroft.
Don't understand you, sir.
Well, it could have been the pie and not the soup that was the cause of the guests all being ill. And perhaps the deceased gentleman ate rather more of it than the others. Do you know if this gentleman ate any of the pie?
Don't know,
muttered Stebbins, looking deflated. Well, there you are then, said Ravenscroft, rising from the table.
My Maisie, she had some of the pie, said Stebbins, hopefully.
And was she ill?
No. So you see, Mr. Ravenscroft, it wasn't the pie at all, nor was it the soup.
Did the scullery maid, this Maisie, did she eat some of the brown Windsor, and was she ill afterwards?
No, sir. She didn't have any of the soup,
said Stebbins, helping himself to the last piece of cheese. So it must have been the soup and not the pie that made all the people ill.
Yes, Mr. Ravenscroft. So you see that the gent must have been poisoned. One of them folks must have poisoned him. You has to do something about it,
pronounced Stebbins. Look, Stebbins, we don't know that anyone was poisoned. We do know that everyone who ate the soup was ill afterwards, but that they all recovered, and that the only person who died was the person who did not partake of the soup.
Exactly. So someone must have killed him off.
The gentleman who died could have been taking some kind of medicine for a particular ailment, and for one reason or another he accidentally took rather too much of it before he retired. People are sometimes very careless with their medicines and how they use them. So you see, there may be a perfectly fair explanation for all of this. You and this Maisie, Stebbins, must not go around telling everyone that the deceased was poisoned on purpose when there is no evidence to suggest that this was the case, said Ravenscroft, seeking to curb the youth's enthusiasm.
You wouldn't say that, Mr. Ravenscroft, if you had seen...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.